So guys, please reply me whether my screen is visible to you.
Yes.
Okay, fine. Anyone else need to join? Or this much? Because after sharing my screen, I can't go back. That's why. Okay, fine. Shall we start?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So in our last classes, we have discussed about this wing tip vertices and downwash, and also what is a finite wing and what is an infinite wing, where wing tips are formed or wing tip vertices are formed, and where the lift will be distributed, and also the induced drag, induced angle of attack, then effective angle of attack and all. So from this class, we will be concentrating about the lifting line theory and also how the lifting line theory will come into picture when because of this vortex filament and all. So you know, the vortex filament is generally in last class itself we have seen this vortex filament. So we know this vortex filament is a straight line which have vertices bound over the straight line. So if two or more vertices in a single straight line means, then that filament is called the vortex filament. Okay. So if you have a vortex filament like this, and it is at a distance from and it has a downwash v or induced velocity v here, then and it is situated at a distance of r from this point P, because the downwash is of this vortex filament is at a distance of r from this point V. When we project like this, so here we have a infinite vortex filament extending from minus infinity to infinity. Sorry for this interruptions and all, because if somebody is joining later means I can't, I need to go back only. Okay. So okay, listen. So what we have here is a vortex filament with its limits extending from minus infinity to infinity. So we have a vortex filament of minus infinity to infinity, and this vortex filament is kept in a vortex flow only. So because it has a vortex bound over it, that a vortex flow bound over it, so it might have this vortex filament also have some induced velocity. Say this induced velocity here also, we can see here it has an induced velocity of dv. Here they have seen as a v, because it has some limits, then we can change that small induced velocity into a induced velocity. Okay, so it is kept at a distance of r from p. When we project here, we will get like this. So this is a vortex filament. It will be in the form of a wire which have a current passing through. Okay. Same way here, we have an induced velocity. If we have consider this like a wire of current passing through, then from Biot-Savart law we can write like this. dv equal to gamma by 4 pi into dl cross r divided by vector of r cube. Okay, so after simplification, what will come in? So like this, we know from this, this induced velocity is dv equal to gamma by 4 pi dl into r divided by r power cube. Okay, we know the cross product of a cross b equal to, anybody know the value for a cross b, cross product? You all studied that, what is cross product?
A b sin theta.
Yes, a that is equal to a, here the it is in the vector format, so we can write like this, into same dl cross r. For that we can write like this, dl into r into sin theta. Okay, so this here r we can write, just write like this, dl into r into sin theta. And also this vector we can write like this, r equal to r vector. Okay, so that is r is the r vector, so that here also this r and r cube will get cancelled, so the remaining terms will be gamma divided by 4 pi into sin theta divided by r square, sin theta divided by r square. Okay, so after that we need, after applying the values from this triangle, that is sin theta equal to h by r and the cos theta equal to some simplifications we are there. Okay, after some simplifications, what we will get means, whether I need to go for all those simplification or we can just away go for the results and all, because what we need from this Biot-Savart law is this two equations only for induced velocity. From the Biot-Savart law, what we got is the induced velocity for an infinite length is equal to gamma by 2 pi h, and also for a semi-infinite vortex filament, or see, for an infinite length, that is minus infinity to infinity, the induced velocity is v equal to gamma by 2 pi h. Okay, 2 pi into h. But for semi-infinite vortex filament means, that is if an vortex filament extends from 0 to infinity or 0 to minus infinity, then the induced velocity will be v equal to gamma divided by 4 pi h. Okay, gamma divided by 4 pi h.
Sir, what is semi-infinite?
Means there is no limits. Okay, it will be extended from minus infinity to plus infinity. That is that's what,
and what is semi-infinite?
Semi-infinite means from one point, some origin to some infinite length. If it is extending from zero to some infinite length means, then that is called semi-infinite vortex filament. Okay. So that's what from Biot-Savart law, the equation what we are got is after from some simplifications and all. We got that v equal to gamma divided by 2 pi h, and also for semi infinite vortex filament, v equal to gamma divided by 4 pi h. Just note down this equation. Please intimate me when you finished. Okay, if you don't, just tell me. Shall I change?
Yes.
Okay. So from this Biot Savart, Helmholtz, he is one of the scientists. He done research on this inviscid and incompressible flow vortex filament for this inviscid and incompressible flow, and he found that the strength of the vortex filament will be, that is two condition for, that is a Helmholtz theorem. Okay, he derived a theorem, and this, because of this theorem, what they are telling is the strength of the vortex filament is constant along its length. So it will be constant along its length, and also the vortex filament cannot end in a fluid, it must extend to the boundaries of the fluid or form a closed path. Okay, and also they have derived some conclusions from this Helmholtz theorem. We will see this conclusions by using the, by deriving some derivations, that is Mandel lifting line theory. That is the important theory, because as I told earlier itself, for a rectangular wing or for a finite wing, the lift distribution won't be same throughout. Okay, the lift distribution changes. Okay, the lift distribution will be,
so there is more background noise.
Yes, there is some background noise, but not in my lap, not from my side.
Some of those Nagappa.
Okay, in our last class itself we have discussed something, that is in an infinite wing the lift distribution will be constant throughout. Okay, that means throughout its length the lift distribution remains the same, but for for a finite wing it won't be remain same, because from the root, at the root the lift distribution will be more, and at the tip the distribution will be very less, because at the tip the pressure will get equalized. So because of that there won't be any sort of lift at the tips. The at the tip the lift will be zero, but when moving from the tip to the root the lift distribution increases. Okay, so that's what is it is here. Lift distribution along the span of a finite wing, that is, this is the span of the finite wing, and we have the lift distribution like this. We will see this how it is distributed, and from how we can calculate the value of this lift and all along this span. Okay, so here what they are mentioning two limits. Okay, same will be in our upcoming sessions also. So this is span, the length of the span is b. The length of the span is b. At the root we will say it is a zero. So from here it is this side we have at the limit is will be 0 to b by 2, and here along this direction it is minus b by 2. That's why the limits are minus b by 2 and plus b by 2. Okay, so next is the wash in and wash out.
So sir, there is no lift on the tip.
Yeah, there won't be any lift on the tip, because
zero.
Yes, it is zero only, because there won't be any upper the pressure at upper and lower side, it remains same. That's why there won't be any lift at the tips. That's why the gamma will be zero at the tip. Okay, if gamma is zero there won't be any lift, because L equal to rho v gamma. Rho v gamma.
Yes.
At the tip alone, okay. Only at the tip, but when moving inside there will be some amount of lift. That's why it is changing like this. The diagram itself you can understand it. At the root there will be more lift, and at the tip we will get some lesser amount of lift. Okay, so in your problems and all they will give some values for this gamma, or some equations. They then ask us to find some induced angle of attack or CDI or lift, some likewise they will ask us to find. Okay, next is the wash in and wash out.
Sir, where did this rho v gamma come from, sir? Which equation is this? Helmholtz equation?
No, this rho v gamma Kutta-Jakubowski theorem.
Okay, sir.
Actually some guys having attended the previous classes and all. So listen guys, I have sent the PPT and also the some videos, so you can see the your videos in the, see this lectures in today, from today onwards, okay, in the forum. So they will upload today itself. I have already sent the videos, so that I don't know whether you got the videos and all, or you have seen the videos and all. Most probably, okay, you will upload it in, today.
You, okay. Sir, you so upload it, you will upload.
No, no, no. I won't upload. I will send to the concern party, sir. That means Aishwarya Dara ma'am, I will send the videos, okay? Then they will upload. Okay. So next is the wash in and wash out. Okay. So have you ever heard this name or this term, this wash in and wash out?
Yes, sir.
Where?
Sir, in aerodynamics, JD Anderson.
Yes, JD Anderson. Okay. Have you seen this type of wings and all? Because the I will here you can see the definition itself. For wash in, if the angle of incidence, that is the alpha I value, okay, increases from root to tip, then that type of wing is called wash in wing. Okay. If for wash out, the angle of attack or angle of incidence decreases from root to tip, okay, then it is called wash out. Okay. So for washing, if the angle of attack is increases from root to tip, sorry, not angle of attack, angle of incident, okay, then it is called wash in. If the angle of incident is decreased from root to tip, then it is called wash out. So just tell me, what is wash in with some alpha degree values, alpha I degree values, okay? Just think that you have an aircraft, you want to assemble some wing over that aircraft, and the cross section of the airfoils at the root is will be NACA 4412, NACA 4412 airfoil, and at the tip we I am giving this NACA 0012 airfoil. What will be the consider it is an washing wing, okay, the wing of that particular aircraft. Consider we can just think that it is an Cessna aircraft, and for Cessna aircraft there are at that root we have one type of wing, and at the tip we are having another one type of airfoil. That is at the root we have 0 4412 airfoil, and at the tip we are I am just giving you 0012 airfoil. Okay, think that is it is a wash in wing. So what will be the degree of angle of incident at the root and at the tip? Just tell me. You can say anyone angle. Do you guys understand what I told?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Then please answer me.
Sir, is the like if angle of attack, you asking about if angle of attack increases?
No. Not angle of attack. The angle of incident. Incident
angle of incident increases.
Alpha
I. Root to tip then.
Ah yes.
Okay. Sir, can you ask question again?
See, we have an wing to assemble in a Cessna aircraft, okay. I have given you two types of airfoils. One will be fitted for root and another one will be fitted at the tip, okay. The root airfoil is 4412 and the tip airfoil is 0012. And the wing what we are going to assemble is a wash in wing, not wash out wing. It is a wash in wing, okay. Suppose it is a wash in wing, what will be the angle of incidence at the root and what will be the angle of incidence at the tip, say with some values, okay. I want some degree angles for this root angle of incident and also the tip angle of incident.
Sir,
sir, would it will be 4 and tip it will be 13.
Tip it will be?
13. I don't know, sir, but I'm just assuming.
No problem. So now consider this. Now think this whether it is increasing or in a decreasing manner. This is a root angle of incidence.
It is increasing.
Then it will be a washing wing. Okay. Suppose opposite happens means here it is 13 degree and here it is 4 degree means then what
then happens? It is decreasing.
It is decreasing and the wing.
Sir, if it is decreasing means then there will be some pressure gradient. Washout wing. No need to worry about just pressure gradient and all. Just think it is a washout wing.
Because it will be helpful for you when you design some aircrafts and or some UAVs and all. What they will do, see if some in some UAVs and all, they will keep some different types of airfoils at the root and also at the tip. Okay. Even for aircrafts also, it is like that only. And also, the have you heard that name, that twist, aerodynamic twist and all?
Aerodynamic twist, yes sir.
Twisting airfoils, twisting wing.
Yes sir.
Same thing only, okay. So, the main purpose is, if you keep washing wing means, the tip will stall first, okay. Washing, if you are keeping... this washing wing, then the tip will stall first, and if you are keeping this washout wing means root will stall first. Okay, that is the condition or that is the effect happens when we choose these two types of airfoils or two types of wings. Okay.
Sir, can you give some examples for this two, for these two scenarios?
Yes.
A real thing example.
This easy only. See here. You only give some examples for this angle of incident. Okay, so if the angle of incident is 4 here means automatically the incidence will that we are keeping the airfoil at some smaller degree angle only. If it is the angle of incident is 13 means just think the what will be the shape of the airfoil or shape of the wing when at the tip. So automatically we know this from 12 to 15 degree and all automatically stalling comes to stalling wing will come over the airfoil. Okay. So if the angle of incident is more at the tip means automatically that that part will stall first. If here it is more means here will stall first. Okay.
Sir, what is the advantage of this wing?
So the actually. This is not advantages and all. Main advantage is we need some geometrical twist to ensure more lift over the span. Okay. So because of this more lift and all, automatically there will be.
Sir, some actually, in which case we may use what? Sir, in which case we can use washing and washout.
That depend upon our design. We can't say like that. Depend upon our design only. Okay. See some for our stability and all.
Wings are actually washing.
Once again, repeat it. I couldn't hear you.
Sir, actually, most of our wings are washing.
No. Some wings it will be wash in and some wings it will be wash out also. Both we can keep.
But for all these rockets and those delta wing configurations, I guess we have wash out.
Yes. See, actually, why they are giving this wash in and all means. Some aircrafts and all we know this dihedral and all it will be more helpful. You all know what is dihedral and all. Dihedral wing, anhedral wing and all.
Yes sir, dihedral wing, I know that.
The stability purpose we will keep. That's why this is the purpose for our... that's the main purpose for this and all. Okay. We will... the stalling and all also. We will reduce the stall by using some wing tips and all. Or winglets and all. We will reduce that part. For that purpose. We will... I will give some realistic examples later. Okay. For this part and all. So you can understand it easily.
Sir, it is like downwash or upwash?
No. Downwash, see, downwash and all, we will have this downwash and all because of the some other. See, if tip is stall first means automatically this upwash will come into picture, okay? When it is stalling means automatically some problems will encounter over the surface of the wing and all. Okay. I couldn't hear you. Hello.
No, sir, I can't speak anything.
Okay, I will give some examples in our next class for over this topic, wash in and wash out. Okay, don't worry about this. But for the condition is, if there is wash in means, the normally the angle of attack, angle of incident will increase from root to tip. If it is wash out means, the angle of incident decreases from root to tip. Okay, then for this purpose only we will be using this if washout is used means the root will stall first, and if wash in is used means the tip will stall first. Okay, other things I will give you some examples over this for this topic. Okay, the next is the geometrical twist and aerodynamic twist. Okay, so same thing only here also. See, you can see here the aerodynamic twist is the difference between the zero lift line of airfoils, that is the alpha of airfoils at the root and also near the tip. Okay, so this tip is to prevent this tip stalling effect. So you can see here this aerodynamic twist, and just compare this aerodynamic twist and wing wash in or wash out. See, if you are having some airfoils at the root, like the airfoil at the root is at 0 degree, means this is at 0 degree, and at the tip we have the airfoils at some -1 degree or 1 degree, then there will be, whether there is a twist or not, there will be some twisting motion for this wing. Okay, so it is twisted somewhat downwards, that is called aerodynamic twist. Okay, then here we can see here the difference between the angle of attack of airfoil sections at the root and near the tip is called the geometrical twist. Okay, so if you are providing some ailerons here, and if you are increasing the angle means, then it will be called as geometrical twist. Okay, or if you are tilting the tip side motion means, then it is called the geometrical twist. Okay, so next is the Prandtl lifting line theory. Okay, see, someone's background noise is there, so please just mute that. Even what you are telling is, I couldn't hear all those things and all. So next is the Prandtl lifting line theory. So by using this lifting line theory, we will find we will find the downwash, that is omega w, then the alpha I, and also this lift li or l value. Okay, so Prandtl lifting line theory is used to find the lift for a finite wing. So for finding the lift for a finite wing, we will be using this Prandtl lifting line theory. Okay, so it is applied to large aspect ratio unswept wings at small angle of attacks. For a minimum angle of attack, we will be using this. Okay, so how we will find this lift over the finite span means, so we can see here the lift distribution is here. Okay, so if the lift distribution here means, automatically we know there will be some vertices bound over the surface of the wing over here. So the vertices which is bound over the surface, we can call that as bound vertex. Okay, the vertices which is bound over the surface is called the bound vertex. And over the tip, we know there will be some free vertices. Okay, or the trailing vertices. If there is finite wing have two wing tips, one at both the ends. Okay, so here also we will be having some trailing vortices, and here also we will be having some trailing vortices. And see, one more thing. So if you are considering one finite being, means first we will take some small portion of this finite being, okay? Then we will, because of this, we will integrate it. We can find the whole portion also, or we can simultaneously take other portions and we can find the lift for along the whole span, okay? So what we are taking here also, we are taking a small portion of the wing, and in that small portion there will be a single bound vortex, and there will be two trailing vortices. That's why I called it as two free vortices or two free trailing vortices, okay? Because at the trailing edge there will be some vortices, and the vortices which is formed at the trailing edge is called the trailing vortices, okay? So I am, if I am taking this is the small portion, means automatically here also there will be one vortices, and here also there will be one vortices, okay? All together it is called a, it will be in the form of a horseshoe. That's why horseshoe vortices come into picture. So horseshoe vortices is a combination of bound vortices plus this two trailing vortices, okay? So the bound vortices with this two trailing vortices is called the horseshoe vortices. So we all know here we are considering the bound vortices, or we are considering this finite wing, and the wing extends from minus b by 2 for this limb here, and plus b by 2 at this tip. So the for finding the lift for this particular airfoil, we need some induced or downwash. So the downwash we can consider this from this Biot Savart law. That is, we can see here dv equal to gamma by 4 pi h, but here it is along the span it will be y, and we are taking here minus b by 2 here, and here plus b by 2. So the equations becomes w of y is the downwash along the span. So the w of y equal to minus gamma by 4 pi b by 2 plus y minus gamma by 4 pi b by 2 minus y, okay? So from this, after some simplifications, what we got here is w of y equal to minus gamma by 4 pi into b divided by b by 2 the whole square minus y square. So the line where all bound vortices formed, or this bound vortices or horseshoe vortices is induced, is called the lifting line. So that's why the equation is called, or the theorem is called the Prandtl lifting line theory, okay? So the theory will be called Prandtl lifting line theory. See, we can see here there are so many vortex filament kept side by side, and in each vortex filament there is a bound vortices bound over the filament. Consider this is a wing of wing, and we have a vortex filament here. So here there is a vortex bound vortices, here it is a bound vortices, and here also there is a bound vortices, and in the side by side we have a bound vortices attached over the surface of the wing. And if you are considering this line, and we'll be having here, we know from the Helmholtz theorem there will be more lift at the root and there will be less lift at the tip. That is, there won't be any lift at the tip. So at minus b by 2 also there won't be any lift, and here also there will be any lift. Okay. So we can solve this equation by applying the limits. So w of y naught equal to minus 1 by 4 pi integral of minus b by 2 to, the limit will be minus b by 2 to b by 2. So as I told earlier, first we will consider one small part. The small part, the gamma, what the circulation over that part is d gamma. So therefore, the equation becomes d gamma divided by dy into dy divided by y naught minus y. The same way we will be applying the some simplifications over here, and we will get this induced velocity for this total induced velocity will be w of just note down this some equations. Okay, no need and all this derivations and all, that's why I am just skipping this derivations and all. If you want means we can see this, otherwise we can just skip this and we can just note down this equations alone. Okay, because for a
sir, please tell us how you derives sir, from which thing you have brought the derivation. That's what you tell and you can proceed.
Okay, see here, initially what we did is we took this small portion of this wing for a finite wing, and the span is span here is y. So here we have taken this minus b by 2, so the limits will be minus b by 2 to minus b by 2. Okay, first of all what we need is we need to find the induced velocity or the downwash, sorry, or we can say the induced velocity also. So the induced velocity w of y naught equal to, we need to find the w of y naught. Okay, so for finding this w of y naught, we all already know from Biot-Savart law we found the induced velocity dv. Here we are taking the w of y naught. For v, we are considering here w of y naught, because w of y naught is the induced velocity over the finite span. So for that, we are considering this w of y naught. Okay. So then, by using this equation, we found this from this equation. Okay. From this equation. Dv equal to gamma divided by 4 pi from this equation only. For here, from this, we derived this equation. V equal to gamma divided by 4 pi h. Same way, we are using this same equation only. And with this equation, we know the span will be y. And is the portion we considered is minus b by 2 and plus b by 2. So it will be and we are considering some small portion over that the induced velocity. So in that small portion, the induced velocity will be the distance h will be b by 2 to plus y over this side, and b by 2 to b by 2 minus y over the other side. Okay, because we are considering like this. I will show you one diagram so that it will be easy for you. Can see here, so we are just taking this dv here, this is a portion of the wing, and up to this distance we will consider this y naught. It will be the span will be total span will be y. Okay, so for this we will get like this, the equation will be simplified and we will get like minus 1 by minus of 1 by 4 pi integral of minus b by 2 to b by 2 d gamma by dy into dy divided by y naught minus y. Okay, so after finding the induced velocity, we can straight away substitute that in induced angle of attack. So the formulas will be alpha a of y naught equal to minus w of y naught divided by b infinity. This we derived from here, this equation. See here, we can say, see here, alpha I, the induced angle of attack, that is alpha I equal to, here we have this induced velocity W here and the free stream velocity V infinity here. So that automatically we can easily write from this, that is alpha I equal to opposite this W divided by V infinity. Okay, same way here we have for this W in our equation, we have w of y naught. Okay, so w of y naught alpha will be, that is equal to w of y naught divided by v infinity. Okay, that is alpha i, that is induced angle of attack. So now we can substitute the w of y naught in this equation. After substituting it, we will get like alpha of y naught equal to 1 by 4 pi v infinity integral of minus b by 2 to b by 2 d gamma by dy into dy divided by y naught minus y. Actually, we have already seen this equations and all, but we don't know where we substituted and all. Sorry for that, but you guys note this all equations, okay? This w of y naught equation, this equation, then alpha I of y naught equation, then finally this lift coefficient. This also we have derived from this airfoil sections only. That is CL equal to A naught into alpha effective of y naught minus alpha L equal to 0. That is, if you are considering cambered airfoil, then this 0 lift angle of attack will come inside. Okay. So that CL equal to A naught into alpha effective of y naught minus alpha L equal to 0. Okay. This A naught is nothing but the lift curve slope. Okay. So after finding the CL, we can straight away substitute in this equation. That is L equal to half rho infinity V infinity square into S into CL. For this S, we know this C of that is a chord length is C. So C of Y naught into 1. For a unit span we are considering is 1. So the equation becomes like this. L equal to half rho infinity V infinity square C of Y naught into CL. That is equal to, from Kutta-Jakubowski theorem, rho infinity v infinity gamma of y naught. Okay. So from this, we can substitute the CL in this equation. So by substituting it, we can substitute here itself. Okay. Half rho infinity v infinity square into C into 2 pi alpha effective minus alpha L equal to 0. Okay. That is equal to rho V gamma. So this 2 get cancelled. Rho get cancelled. V infinity square. V infinity will get cancelled. So the remaining terms will be alpha effective equal to gamma of y naught divided by, you can see from here, alpha effective will be gamma. So here we know this gamma equal to gamma of y naught only. So alpha effective will be gamma of y naught divided by V infinity into pi. This equation will be V infinity into pi into C of y naught plus alpha L equal to 0. Okay. Have you noted these equations? Just note this 4 equations. One, this one, this one, this one, and this one. Just tell me when you finished. guys.
Yes, sir.
Finished?
Just one minute. Shall I change? Yes, sir.
So after substituting this value here, alpha effective value here, we can find the CLS, CL equal to 2 gamma of y naught divided by V infinity into C of y naught. Okay. That is CL equal to 2 pi into alpha effective of y naught minus alpha L equal to 0. So by substituting this automatically, here also alpha L equal to 0, there will be here also there is alpha L equal to 0. So this term and that term will get both will get neglected. Then remaining what we have is 2 into gamma of y naught divided by V infinity into C of y naught. Okay. So now we found the value for CL. For finding the value of CL, what we need is we need to find the gamma of y naught. For finding the value of alpha effective also, what we need is we need to find the circulation value along. Okay. After finding the circulation value, and if we know the zero lift angle of attack value, we can easily find the alpha effective value also. In the same way, for finding the induced angle of attack, what we need is we need to see this, or we need to find the induced velocity. If you know the value of induced velocity, we can easily substitute and find the value of this induced angle of attack. Okay. Then finally we know this here you can see alpha of y naught. Totally we know this alpha of y naught equal to gamma of y naught divided by this is from alpha effective, that is alpha equal to alpha effective plus this alpha I of y naught, that is from this equation. We know this alpha effective will be alpha minus, that is equal to alpha minus alpha I. So from this alpha equal to alpha effective plus alpha effective plus alpha I. So already we know the value of alpha I and also we found the value of alpha effective. So from this we can easily find the value for alpha. Okay. So that's all from the Prandtl lifting line theory. So in the we have some small confusion in this wash in and wash out, right? See here, if you are using this wash in wing means, automatically from the wash in itself we can easily say the tip angle of incidence is more. Okay, if the tip angle of incidence will be more means at if the alpha angle of attack will be 3 degree means automatically the angle of attack of at the tip will be at some 5 degree angle or some 6 degree angles, because there will be some angle of incidence at the tip. Okay, that means the tip we will be getting more angle of attack and we will be getting less angle of attack at the root, so that the tip will get more lift. So if you want more lift, we can use this wash in wing, and if you want less lift, we can use this wash out wing. But if there is more lift at the tip, means automatically the tip will stall first. Okay.
If the washout wing is more efficient,
washout wing is more efficient. That's why we are using this washout wing for aircrafts and all. But we won't use this some aircrafts only or some UAVs only. We will be using this wash in wing. Okay. For that part also, for if you want to get some optimum value for this lift means, then we will use this washout wing with some winglets. If you are using some winglets, we will get more lift at the tip, some optimum lift. Okay, we can optimize the lift by using the some winglets. If you are using some winglets means automatically we can increase the lift at the tip and all. Okay, suppose that happens means if you have the tip is stalling first means automatically there will be some instability occur in the flight dynamic instability will occur. Okay, automatically some spinning moments or some things will occur. That's why we won't use this wash in wing, we will go for this wash out wing. Okay, so we have one problem to solve. I think in our next class we can solve that problem tomorrow, or maybe tomorrow I will message you when I will continue our next class. Okay, maximum in our tomorrow's class we can solve that sum. Okay
sir. So last week we didn't have mock test.
So actually this your mock test and all, they will continue, they will assign the test for the mock test and all. Okay.
And currently we are taking aerodynamics course.
Yes, now we are continuing the aerodynamics only. Well, actually in aerodynamics they haven't given mock tests, right? What? I couldn't hear you.
When will be mock test?
I don't know. That Aishwarya Dara ma'am will intimate you, okay?
Sir, before mock test, please upload the notes.
I upload my notes for up to today's class. I have uploaded the notes. Okay, we can refer that PPT. I have uploaded and other videos. One 3 to 4 videos I have uploaded. Remaining things only I need to upload. I will upload that. Okay, before that, before your mock test, I will upload. Okay.
Sir, when is the next class?
Maximum tomorrow or day after tomorrow? Tomorrow maximum I will continue our next class tomorrow itself. Okay.
Okay, sir, inform on the group.
I will inform you.
Sir, it would be better if we had more classes, sir, because after 5 days, after 1 week, if we are attending the classes, I think it's a very large gap for the preparation.
Yes, sir, it's totally blank for us. We forgot everything.
Okay, I will ask them, I will arrange you. Okay.
At least there is alternate class, like in MWF or TTS. Like there is 3 class in a week. There is no burden for you also, and there is no burden for us also.
Okay, okay, okay. We can
you can do alternate classes like Monday, Wednesday, Friday, or otherwise Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday. And the Sunday will be off, or the mock test you will.
Sir,
yes.
Actually, it takes a lot, sir. I mean, after our last day, we are attending the classes. I think like that. So it's a kind of suggestion from our side, sir.
Schedule only I couldn't have classes in Saturday and Sunday. I actually planned to take class on Saturday and Sunday, but I don't get time to take classes, that's why. But don't worry, we will make arrangements for that and we can revise it.
At least three classes in a week, because I think it's better if it's alternate. Sunday we can do mock test on Sunday.
Okay, we can make like that, okay. Don't worry, I will ask them and I will arrange.
Do a chit-chat with everyone, then we see.
Okay, fine. Today we can wind up here. Tomorrow most probably we can have the classes, okay?
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.